Grace and peace be multiplied to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I bring you greetings from Christ Temple Church, where we are a Christ-centered church connecting people to Jesus Christ and to one another. And we want to encourage you today to love your neighbor as yourself. And so I just want to give you all a few reminders. Tune in to our Sunday school this morning at 9:30 a.m. via Zoom. We also want to encourage you to continue to support the church through your tithes and offering. And you can do that through our website, which is christtemplela.org, or simply go and use Venmo, which is christtemplela with two T's. We also want to say a special happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. We have a special presentation during our worship service for you as mothers to recognize you. We also will be blessed by a message this morning from our own pastor, Bishop Emery Lindsay. We certainly hope that you are blessed and encouraged as you listen to the message and the Word of God. Also, a reminder that next Sunday we'll have our monthly parking lot service at 10:30 a.m., and we hope to see you there. May God bless you and may God keep you. Enjoy your week.
Jesus, 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 Jes by saying Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers that are out there today. You know, being a mother is a blessing. I think of motherhood as a high calling and a high privilege. You know, the Lord blessed me to have 6 children and 13 grandchildren, and I am just so grateful for the honor that He entrusted me to have children. And this morning, I know there's a lot of mothers that may be listening. For my family, this is our first Mother's Day without our mother. The Lord took her home back in December, but I just thank God for the seeds that she planted in our lives. And I just want to say that when it comes to mothering, we have our ups and downs, we have our challenges, we have our sleepless nights, we shed our tears, but thank God that He has promised to always be there with us. And so today I just like to encourage each of your hearts and know that He is God and He loves us and He is going to give us the strength that we need to carry on. So may God bless you and may you have a wonderful, wonderful Mother's Day. And the song this morning that I'm going to be singing is Yesterday. I pray that it'll be a source of encouragement to each of you. Either I'm gonna trust you, or I may as well walk away. 'Cause stressing don't make it better, don't make it better, no way. See, I decided that I cried my last tear yesterday. Trust in you. Oh,
Good morning. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. I'd like to invite your attention this morning to the book of Ruth, chapter 1 and verse 15. The book of Ruth, the Old Testament book, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, chapter 1, verse 15. And I shall read. And she said, "Look, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go, and wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your God shall be my God, your people shall be my people, and where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts you and me." When she saw that she was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking to her. Now the two of them went until they came to Bethlehem. And it happened when they came to Bethlehem that all the city was excited because of them. And the women said, "Is this Naomi?" But she said to them, "Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara. For the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me?" So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, who returned from the country of Moab. Now they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. Plant the right seeds. I'm so delighted to have the opportunity this morning to pay tribute, to give honor, to acknowledge all of our mothers. It is indeed a wonderful joy to be able to salute mothers who are so worthy of our honor and praise. As Proverbs 31 will remind us, the woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Few things in life are of more value than a godly mother. Mothers, as we recognize you today, I would like to come through the device that you're using to hear this message, and I'd like to be able to personally pray for you and thank God for you and your ministry to your family. I would also like to present flowers to you and just be a blessing today on behalf of Christ Temple, the people of God. And since I cannot come to you in your home this morning, I have invited Pearl to stay with us this morning after she has ministered so wonderfully and beautifully in song. And I'm going to present some flowers to her as a token of my love, affection, appreciation for her, and just giving God thanks that she has been a wonderful mother for our six children. And therefore today, Pearl, I want to say I thank God for you. I bless you in the name of the Lord. Amen.
God bless you. Thank you.
I especially want to acknowledge mothers of the, I want to say, use the words of the African diaspora. Mothers of color. When I think of you, I think of struggle. I think of challenge. I think of also pain and also success. I think you could readily identify with the words of James Weldon Johnson in the poem "Mother to Son." He has written so eloquently, "Well, son, I'll tell you, life for me ain't been no crystal stair. It's had tacks in it and splinters and boards torn up. and places with no carpet on the floor. But all the time I've been a-climbing on and reaching landings and turning corners and sometimes going in the dark where there ain't been no light. So boy, don't you turn back. Don't you sit down on the steps because you find it kind of hard. Don't you fall now, for I still going, honey. I still climbing, and life for me ain't been no crystal stair. How many mothers would say and identify with the words of James Weldon Johnson, life for me ain't been no crystal stairs? Black mothers, mothers of the African diaspora, have had their share and then some. Their share of pain, their share of poverty, their share of parenting challenges, their share of problems, and their share of promise. But I believe that many of you would say, through it all, God has been faithful. God has made a way. God has opened a door. I want to take you into the life of a woman of color, this woman, a woman who was no stranger to sorrow and sadness, a woman who went from famine to fullness. I can't help but think of our losses this year, the losses of so many due to COVID-19 and the pandemic. The losses that we've had this year as black men and women have been struck down by police many times, struck down so horribly. I think of George Floyd and some of his last words as he called out to mama. It can make you ask, where is God? If anyone had a right to ask that question, it was Naomi in the book of Ruth. Her story is a story for people in the midst of tough times. The story of Naomi occurs during the days of the judges. The days of the judges capture a very unique period in the life of the nation Israel. It really was a rather dark chapter in Israel's life because the Bible says of that period of time that everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And whenever men do what's right in their own eyes, they generally drift away from God. Israel had drifted away from her spiritual foundations due to her disregard for God's commandments, due to her waywardness. God allowed famine to strike the land. Things became so desperate in the land of Israel, and especially around the town of Bethlehem, that Elimelech, he decided to take his wife Naomi and his two sons, and they traveled to the land of Moab, the country that was next door. It's so interesting that they should leave Bethlehem, which means the house of bread, to travel to a land that was occupied by those who were normally the enemies of the nation Israel. But Elimelech took his family. They moved to the land of Moab. They were not going to dwell there permanently. They were just going to go there for a while until the famine was over. Just a short season, as it were. He would be a foreigner or an alien, an immigrant in a strange land. So he says goodbye to family and friends, packs up the wife and the children, and then he strikes out to sojourn for a season in the land of Moab. But there in the land of Moab, tragedy strikes. Elimelech dies. He's never going to make it back home again. And in those days, when you lost your spouse, as Naomi had just lost Elimelech, the future began to look very bleak and grim because the wife was so dependent upon her husband for her livelihood and the household sustenance. The wife has a dilemma on her hands. How in the world is she going to make it? Where is the next meal going to come from? How will the bills be paid? Naomi is not only though going to lose Elimelech, her husband, Naomi is going to be hit with a double whammy. Not so long after her husband Elimelech dies, her two sons also die. And Naomi is truly alone. Naomi is now left in a foreign land with these daughter-in-laws that her sons had married. So they are Moabites, and this is all that Naomi has. She no longer has any certainty for her future, because not only has her husband died, but now her two sons have died, and her life is desperately turned upside down. What is she going to do? How will she make it? She's lost a husband. She's lost her children. Her future is so very uncertain. When the husband and the sons are gone, it means that the wife many times is reduced to a life of not only great poverty, but a life of begging, a life of living from hand to mouth, a life that depends on the generosity and the mercy of others. Naomi has suffered tragedy upon tragedy. The famine took her to the land of Moab, and all that she has known in the land of Moab is funeral after funeral. These are desperate days and desperate times in the life of Naomi, the daughter of Israel. Moab has certainly not been kind to this daughter who had moved from Bethlehem following her husband into the land of Moab, but now all of her closest family members are gone. Just Ruth and Oprah, these daughter-in-laws, are left, aliens and strangers in a foreign land, are not always welcome. Naomi has her back up against the fence. But Naomi hears that it has begun once again to rain in the land of Israel, and there is once more bread at home. So since there is now a recovery in the land of Bethlehem, the days of famine are over, the people's fortunes have changed, things are looking up, that Naomi decides to return to her homeland. She's going to leave the land of Moab behind. So she informs her daughter-in-laws that she's going to go back to her homeland, back to the town of Bethlehem, and she's going to return and see what the future holds. She prays that God will go before her and that God will open the doors that are necessary. She says to her daughter-in-laws that they should just return to the home of their mothers, because she's definitely appreciative of their kindness to her and to her sons. And Naomi asked the Lord's blessings upon these faithful daughter-in-laws. She wishes them well. She prays that they will return to their own mother's home and that they will marry and have family. They kiss, and after they kiss farewell one to another, the Bible reveals that they all just collapse on one another and weep and shed many, many tears. The daughter-in-laws protest. They are willing to go back with Naomi. They tell Naomi, "We want to go with you back to the land of Israel, back to your hometown, Bethlehem." But Naomi asks a very penetrating question. Why would you do that? I'm too old to marry. I'm too old now to have a husband and to have sons again. There is no future if you go with me, if you follow me. And if I were to marry, and if I were to bear sons, would you be willing to wait until they are grown to marry one of them so that you could have a family by one of my sons? Naomi says, no, that's highly unlikely. She says, God's hand has been against me. She felt like she had been dealt a hand of adversity. She was bitter and angry. Life had not worked out so well for Naomi. And as she shares her pain with her daughter-in-laws, once again they have a meltdown and they cry and shed many tears. And then they decide to part and go their separate ways. Oprah kisses her mother-in-law, and she does the logical things. She heads off back to her own people, the Moabites. She heads away to start a new life, find another husband, and to begin a family. But Ruth, the other daughter-in-law, is of a different mind, because Naomi had planted some seeds in the heart and life of Ruth that Ruth could not escape. Ruth says to her mother-in-law, Naomi, do not ask me to leave. For wherever you go, I will go. And where you live, I am going to live there also. And your people are going to be my people. And your God shall be my God. And wherever you die, I will die also. Ruth says to her mother-in-law, so sincerely, I will let nothing but death separate us. And when Naomi realized that Ruth had made up her mind and that she was determined to go with her, the Bible says that Naomi left off speaking to her. And Ruth followed Naomi back to her hometown, Bethlehem. And when Naomi and Ruth entered the town, the people of the town, they recognized Naomi. And word began to be told all over town that Naomi has returned. But Naomi, in her pain, in her bitterness, in her sorrow, she said to those town people who came out to welcome and receive her, don't call me Naomi, because the name Naomi meant pleasant. Call me Mara, meaning bitter. Life had been no crystal stairs for Naomi. And Naomi felt that she had been abandoned by God in her plight, in her struggle, and in her life experience. After all, there had been the loss of a husband. There had been the loss of both of her sons. She felt abandoned by God, and her heart overflowed with pain and sorrow and sadness. But God has a way. God has a way when we feel abandoned, when we feel full of life's pain and sorrow, and often motherhood will bring that to us when we see a child or a grandchild go astray and we wonder, is there any hope? Is there any help? But God, in His great grace and mercy, God is going to allow this daughter-in-law who followed her back home, Ruth. Ruth is going to go into the field of a man by the name of Boaz. And Boaz is going to bless Ruth in an unusual way. Ruth finds favor with Boaz because God had touched his heart. And Boaz is going to welcome Ruth into his field and into his life. And Boaz is going to marry Ruth, this daughter-in-law. And Boaz is going to have a child by her. And this child will be the father of Obed, who will be the father of Jesse. And Jesse is going to be the father of that great king of Israel, King David. Israel's greatest king and military leader, the house and the lineage of David from which Christ the Lord shall be born. The Messiah is going to come because God had not abandoned Naomi in all of her pain. But God is going to use her dire circumstances, her desperate situation, and from her commitment, her daughter-in-law's commitment, the Christ child is going to come into the world. Naomi thought she had been abandoned, but God had a plan for her life, and God has a plan for your life even when you feel abandoned today. Oh, black mother, you may feel that you have been abandoned by God at times, and you wonder where is God in the midst of the pain that your children may experience, but God has a plan. And our God is the God who is the author of Romans 8:28. And all things work together for good to those who love God and who are called according to His purpose. With God, all things are possible. And our God can take all of our present pain and perplexities and somehow weave through it all His perfect will. I just want to encourage every mother today to plant the right seed in the heart of your child, to plant the right seed in the hearts of those whom you come in contact with, because you never know how those seeds will blossom, how those seeds will come to fruition in faith toward Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. The great question is, do you know Him today, Mother? And are you able to plant those seeds of godliness and righteousness and Christ in the life of your offspring, in the life of those whom you influence? Will you use that influence for the kingdom? Naomi somehow was able to plant seed in the heart of Ruth. And that seed took root, and Ruth refused to leave Naomi because she saw something in Naomi's life. She saw a faith in the only true and living God. Remember the words of our founder, Charles Price Jones. This is the God that we serve. A God who will make the darkness light before us. What is wrong, He'll make it right. All our battles He will fight before us, and the high places He will bring down. Our God is more than able. And I want to encourage you today on this Mother's Day to never give up, to realize that behind it all, God is at work, and He has a wonderful plan. Let us be faithful in planting and sowing the seeds of righteousness into the lives of our family, because we never know how the seed planted is going to blossom and bloom and give glory to the Lord our God. The question I would ask now: do you know Him? Are you following Him every day of your life? Is He Savior and Lord to you? I ask you this morning that if you are far from God, that you might take these moments and that you might hear the Spirit of God speaking through my voice. And today, you may open your heart and life and draw near to the God who loves you with an everlasting love. Remember, Christ died for our sins, and He calls us to confess with our mouth, to believe in our heart, the Lord Jesus Christ, that God has raised Him from the dead. And as we confess and believe, He will become our Savior and our Lord, because the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Let's call upon that name this morning. Father God, we bow in your holy presence and we thank you for the life and the inspiration of Naomi, who sowed seeds into the life of her daughter-in-law, Ruth, so that Ruth would not go back to her gods, but she was going to cleave to the God of Israel, the God Jehovah, the God who was going to send his son Christ into the world. And that Christ was going to go to the cross in our place, bear our sins in his body. And we know that if we confess our faith in you today, you will forgive us, you will give us eternal life, and you will cause us to walk in the knowledge and wisdom of the Lord our God. Lord, as we hear your word today, may we believe and obey, and may we go from famine to fullness, knowing that our God is able. In Jesus' name, amen.